All right, well, let's talk about the McGrattan fight then. That's your favorite fight. Did you know going in there you're gonna fight him?
No, but what happened? Because we were just we had nothing going. I think we were losing 1 or 2-0. I'm not sure, but we just had like nothing really going. Oh, let's see, it's right here. Yeah, we're losing 2-0 in Nashville. And yeah, there's just like we had no pressure, no nothing going on, and I was kind of looking for him, and then the whistle went, and then I just remember I looked at him off the draw, and he's just like he's real cocky about it. He was like, "You want one?" He's like, "Maybe if you want one, yeah."
And then you just went in. So when you go into those games, you're not looking forward to fight. Like you don't go in there geared up, like, "Oh man, I gotta fight this guy."
No, I never went in like. I never went in looking for a fight, but I always went in knowing who I might have to fight.
Yeah.
If that makes sense.
Yeah. I see. I was the complete opposite where I would just like mind screw myself before a game. It's like, oh my gosh, I got to fight Reaves tonight. And I would just be so worked up. I wouldn't be able to concentrate on the game. It was so bizarre.
And that's part of the reason why, because there were a couple games when, you know, something might've happened the game before and I knew that I would have to fight. And when I'm only thinking about the fight, my game goes down the drain. I can't play. I can't concentrate on anything else. Yeah. I'm so amped up about the fight that I just like my mind just goes just to that.
That's perfect. I'm watching it now. So you guys kind of touch sticks, and then you said something, and the ref jumps in. What do you say? Like, are you gonna do this?
I think it's like you want to give me one or something. And I can't remember what he said. And then there's the whistle. We kind of separate, and. Yeah. He just looks at me, and I said, "You gonna give me one?" And he just goes, "Yeah, okay."
So you guys, do you know he like? What's your strategy? Did you watch fights before the fight with him? You know how he jumps in, or?
Yeah, so the strategy I usually go in with to fights is a little different with him. It's tougher to do with bigger guys, but so that summer. When I was boxing, I do what's called throw through the eyes.
Yeah.
And so it's when you kind of like, if you're holding out like this and you throw and you drop your head at the same time.
Yeah.
So basically the only thing that can really, you can only get caught with is a perfectly timed counter uppercut.
Yeah.
And that's tough to do. You know, if you're a good fighter, you can do it. But, you know, you kind of tuck your chin a little, you throw through your eyes. So you're just kind of looking through the top of your eyes. And that's how I went into it with him because he's, you know, he's a big boy. He has the reach. He's got fucking huge hands.
Yeah.
Strong. And so I didn't want to just sit there and go toe-to-toe with him. And that was also because my confidence in fighting wasn't where it is today because he kind of brought it to that.
He has such an intimidating start of a fight when he kind of leans over. It's just, yeah, man. Yeah, you guys just go toe-to-toe. And that's – throwing through the eyes, that's tough because when I was always training for fighting, I used to do boxing too, and I would always wait for a guy to throw, and that's when I would throw back. I'm like, okay.
Counterpuncher, yeah.
Yeah, he's not playing defense right now. He's on offense. And when you duck your head, it was impossible to hit. That's what happened when we fought. You threw, and then I threw, and I just threw right over top of you.
Yeah, we both.
And it was just kind of – I just saw your head. I was like, I'm going to knock his block off, and you were gone. It didn't work out at all. So after that, you must have been like, that's got to be such a cool feeling. Because I fought Peros. He was my first big fight. And I did pretty well. And after that, I was just like, yeah, I can handle anything.
Yeah. This it's so true. You like when you know, especially for me, because I wasn't – when I was in junior, I had 14 fights in 3 years. I wasn't a fighter.
Yeah.
I only fought because I played really physical. So I just naturally had to. But I never went out.
Where did you play junior?
Brandon.
And you only fought 14. How is that possible?
I always played on top two lines. I was I played the same style. I was physical, but so Kelly McCrimmon was the coach, who's the GM here right now. And he liked that I would just, you know, I'd put the puck in. I'd go run somebody. The top two guys would come in, get the puck, and they'd go score. And I didn't get a ton of points, but I created a lot of offense that way.
Yeah.
And so I wasn't really really matching up a lot against those guys. And I also, I wouldn't say I didn't like it. I mean, yeah, maybe I didn't quite love it. My first ever fight, I fought a 20-year-old, and I popped my shoulder out. And that was kind of like made me shy, not shy away from it, but it just made me a little more hesitant.
A little gun shy, yeah.
Yeah. I didn't really become a fighter until after my first year in Peoria.
Do you like it? Do you enjoy fighting?
Yeah, I don't mind it. I like it a lot more now that I know how to do it properly. Now that I know that I'm, you know, I actually know that I'm tough.
Yeah.
It's tougher when you don't, it's tougher when you go into fights thinking that you might get beat up.
Yeah.
You know, like when I go fight McGraden, it's like, fuck, I might get dummied here.
Yeah.
But when you go into it being like, no, I am the toughest guy in the league. You know, whether you're fighting somebody really tough or not, like going against Ross Johnson, he's a big boy and he's tough. I know that.
Yeah.
But I know he's not going to beat the wheels off me. Yeah. And I know I have the confidence to beat him. So, it's definitely a different mindset these days.
It's got to be such a good feeling to just – because you know you're not going to get into a fight for 10 games, 15 games at a time. There's just no one to fight.
Right, yeah.
Just go out and play hockey. I never had that, man. That's got to be – it's such a good feeling. Like, man, I don't have to worry about fighting at all.
Just it is nice, hockey, yeah.
Bang a couple of bodies. Like, that's so – such a luxury. You're – when I look at players, I'm like, you and Tom Wilson are my two guys, so I respect the way you guys play. You fight. You play hard. It's just cool, man. You did well. You did really good.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Really impressed by the way you're playing. And I think you got at least 3, 4, 5 years left. It's crazy.
I'm hoping. Yeah, I'm hoping I can get them all in Vegas too, because the city's just – it's so fun playing on this team. Like, I've never had so much fun playing on a team before.
Yeah.
It's out of control.
You'll get a cup there too. How's that new coach, DeBoer?
He's really good. You know, yeah. He's it was tough seeing Turk go. You know, I really like Turk. Everybody really liked him. He was just, you know, he was a player's coach. But, you know, I think the way, you know, the systems that DeBoer brought in definitely helped our team. You know, our D-zone is – we're getting out of our D-zone so much easier now, and that's leading to more offense. It's shutting down these top teams' offense because we're on them a little bit quicker. I think we were a little too passive before.
Yeah. All right. So we talked about McGraden. We were talking about Sabourin earlier, talking about guys coming to the AHL. He probably fought a ton down there. You don't really know him. Same thing happened to me with Justin Johnson, where he beat the doors off me. So who let you know about Sabourin on your team? Was it your staff, a guy on your team?
Oh, Malcolm Subban, actually. He okay. Because like when we look at the lineup before the game, I always, you know, look at the fourth line and ask guys, who's this guy? And Subs was like, this guy literally beat up everybody in the AHL all year. He's like one of the toughest guys he's ever played with. I was like, oh, okay, well, maybe I should take a look.
Yeah,
saw he was a lefty, so in my head, he's a young kid coming up in the NHL, he's probably gonna ask me to go right away, so I just got to be ready for that. And he asked me, and I said, you know what, I don't like fighting right off my first shift, because, you know, when I fought Ross Johnson, we fought off the opening draw. So I'm sitting for 5 minutes. There wasn't a whistle until there was just a bunch of icings. Then there was – so I get out at like 10 minutes. Then there was two penalties. So I didn't actually get a shift until like 7 minutes. Yeah. And now my legs are shot.
Yeah.
And so I like getting at least one or two shifts in. You know, this kid lines up. He's like, hey, you got to give me one. I was like, listen, I'm going to go run somebody. You can come after me. He's like, no, you got to give me one right now. And he just – it's the same thing with the Biz fight. He gave me, like, this little slew foot move, and it didn't make me, like, fall or anything.
Can't stand that.
Just when guys kick my feet or give me a little tap, like a slew foot, whatever – it makes my wires cross. Nothing makes my wires cross except for that. I don't know why. I just find it so disrespectful.
A lack of respect. I was just going to say that.
Yeah.
Don't embarrass me in front of everybody and try to make me
right.
Like, you don't know how to skate. Right. Like you.
And so he did that, and he did the kind of back off, like, I'm challenging you in your arena. I was like, okay, well, yeah, I'm not going to let you do that. And so, yeah, he lines up left, and I remember watching somebody break down the fight. And they were talking about how his feet, he looked like he was
terrified.
Nervous. Yeah. Like he was bouncing around everywhere and I didn't move. Like I was stone cold.
Now why did you do that? Why did you, cause I know like when we fought, you were like kind of, it was a quick fight when we did it. But when, like, why do you do that? Like, just like,
I think it's part of the technique that I kind of learned over the years. Actually, I learned it through the mouth of Dan Carcillo. So when I fought, what's that?
Tell me how that happened.
So when we fought, he was like, he had me tied up here and I just grabbed his hand and I moved it. And I was holding it and I threw, and you can see like I hit him and he kind of like, he let his hands go. And he looked at me in the box and he goes, "What the hell was that?" I was like, "What?" He's like, "Why are you holding my hand like that?" I had no idea what to do. Mm-hmm. And I remember I looked back at the fights and you could tell, like, when I was holding his hand, there was panic on his face because he had no leverage. And so now when I fight, my main goal is to make you uncomfortable in where you're grabbing.
Yeah.
So if you want to grab me here, I want you to grab anywhere else but there. And so I've learned over the days that changing somebody's grabbing hand makes them uncomfortable in their fighting stance.
That's so funny you say that, because when I would train in the summer, I worked with a guy in Minneapolis. And he would get us to watch your fights.
Oh, yeah?
Me and Boogie, Derek Bugard, we'd be training. We'd be like, "Look at Reaves. He's grabbing here and he grabs the wrist. He's like, he's trying to break your grip."
Yeah.
And we would sit there and be like, "Oh, wow, okay, that's actually a good move." And he was like, "Well, when he's trying to do that, you just start firing away, like throwing as hard as you can, because you don't want him to do that."
Yeah, no, exactly. And you know, like, I could be telling my secrets here, but the point of the matter is, if you try and, you know, if somebody listens to this and all of a sudden, okay, well, I'm just not going to let him do that. But yeah, you can grab me here and I'm strong enough that I can hold you off until I move that hand. Yeah. And also if you try and focus too much on that, I'm just going to start throwing.
Yeah, it's one thing. Things change. So, you know, like, knuckles thrown at you.
Yeah, like people have said, "Well, don't give your secrets away." But it's like there's a way to adjust to that, because if you focus too much on what I'm doing, now you're not focusing on what you're doing, and then I got you a different way.
Well, and people, like, videos out there, people talk about this. People like, "Oh, John, right, you don't have the left hand." I'm like, "I know. I don't
throw left." Oh, yeah. I don't have a left either. So that's why, when I watch Sabrin's fights, when he comes in, he tries to throw right away.
Yeah.
And so I knew that. So all I was doing was looking at his left, and he threw, and I remember I caught his punch.
Yeah.
And I threw it down.
So that was intentional. You meant to do that.
Yeah. So cool. I threw it down, and that one little throw changed the way his stance was. So his next punch wouldn't have been on target where he wanted to be. And it moved him enough that I could throw it down and throw quicker than he could recover and throw. And so I caught him with those next two. And then another thing I always look for is, if somebody has a grip on you and you throw a punch and you feel that grip let go, you know you've caught him and you know he's now panicking.
Because
nobody lets go and tries to hug if they didn't get caught.
Yeah.
They only do that if they got caught with one. And so when I feel somebody's grip change drastically or completely let go, I try and throw as much as I can, because he's now panicking and it's tough to recover while you're panicking and getting thrown at.
Yeah. Oh, it's impossible. And then this happens in your fights all the time, I notice, when the guys do panic and you end up getting the back of their head.
Always.
Like, what do you do? Like, do you try to bury him in the back of the head or just kind of take him down? Like,
no. When you get a guy panicking, when I get at somebody panicking, they tend to, because I usually have reach on guys.
Yeah.
They tend to not, you know, cause especially I'm not fighting, you know, little guys. I'm fighting guys who are, you know, supposed to be tough. So they try not to go down. But when they do that, they basically try and get as far away from me as they can. So they extend their holding hand and they turn their head right and down. Mm-hmm. And when you do that, you're looking at ice and you don't know what's coming at you. So, you know, naturally the only thing I can really hit is the back of your head, but I try and punch your neck, because when you get hit in the neck, it hurts. Like, I've been punched there before, and like, it makes you see stars. And if you're getting beat on the back of the neck while you're looking at the ice, the fight's usually over.
Yeah, yeah, the next. I knocked out Thornton with the neck shot, and everyone's like, you didn't even hit him.
I was like, oh, no, those hurt. I got jumped in the East Coast during the lockout, and the coach told me, the coach brought me in and said, listen, just come play with us until the lockout ends. And he said, if you fight one time, I'll send you back to Winnipeg. It's like, I'm not letting you break your hand. And sure enough, the first game, I got jumped. And I was bent over their bench, and this guy's, like, feeding me in the back of the head, and I'm just, like, laughing at their bench. But then he caught me with one in the neck, and I just saw stars everywhere. I was like, oh, damn. I should probably turn around and protect myself here.
That's funny, man. That's interesting. So, yeah, you beat Sabourin up. You beat up McGrattan. Let's talk about – you mentioned Bissonnette.
Yeah.
I wouldn't consider him a heavyweight. I would consider him kind of a light heavyweight.
Yeah.
You know, he wasn't the scariest of guys. He was a good technical fighter. And then I watched that fight that you fought him, and you just ragdolled him.
Yeah. So that was like, you know, I fought McGrattan the year before that, and, you know, my confidence was up. And it's funny because I talk to Biz about this fight all the time. So we come out, and Hitch was yelling at me, don't you fight him. Like, we don't need you to fight him. Like, you should play your game. And it was the exact same thing. You can see it on the replay. We line up next to each other, and he gave me a little kick to the back of my foot. And again, I'm still in my stance. It just moved my foot, but it made my wires cross. I was like, all right, fine, let's go. And I got a better grip on him than he did on me right off the bat, and I caught him with two early ones. And it was the same thing where he turned his head, and for some reason I didn't go for the back of the neck. I just went for the takedown.
WWE.
But yeah, it was – I think I caught him with one pretty hard early, and the second one, I don't know how hard I caught him, but he immediately went to survival mode. And I think, you know, my confidence was high at that time, but it wasn't high enough that I wanted to give him a chance to come back in the fight. And I think that's why I took him down.
Yeah, that was a good fight. Quick one, but effective. All right, we'll end on our fight.
Okay.
Not a great fight.
No, not one of our best at all.
I don't know why we didn't fight more. I honestly don't. I was a little nervous about you. I didn't like fighting. I don't want to call you smaller, but you were, what, 6'1", 6'2"?
6'2", yeah.
I didn't like fighting. I liked fighting the Bordalos, the taller guys, the Frazier McLarens, those guys. I felt like they were not as good as fighting, and I just didn't expect from you. So if I remember the play, there was a scrum. We were up by like 2 or 3. Was it the end of the game? I can't
remember. It was really close then.
We were winning, and then I saw Peter Angelo – give somebody on my team a shot. So I just cross-checked him from behind.
Yeah.
And then I think you horse-collared me from behind or something. I can't remember.
Yeah. So, yeah, you cross-check Petro. He falls down. And, again, I'm young. I'm the new guy that just replaced Cam Jansen as, you know, the tough guy on the team.
So was that your first year?
No, I don't think it was. No, let's see.
Second
I don't
think year?
I can't. Let's take a look here.
Because I remember I used to fight Jansen all the time, and then you came in. I was like, whoa, who's this kid?
Yeah.
And kid, I'm not.
Are you HN or – oh, yeah, there we go.
HN.
Yeah. So that's February 2012. So that would have been my second year.
Okay.
Yeah. So maybe third – no, second, yeah.
So before that game, were you – nervous to fight? Did you want to fight me? You're a young kid. Impression? Because I thought once we went up by a few, I'm like, well, he's going to ask me to go for sure.
Hitch always told me not to fight you. Like, every time. You know what? That was always the problem I had with Hitch was, like, he'd be like, you know, don't you fight John Scott. He's, you know, he plays 4 minutes a night, blah, blah, blah. And I would look at Hitch, I was like, Hitch, you play me 4 minutes a night sometimes. Like, you can't. And that was why he told me not to fight Biz. But it's like, well, you can't tell me that I can't fight somebody that fights or that plays 4 minutes a night because that's all he plays when that's all you play me sometimes. Like, you either got to play me more or I'm going to have to start fighting these guys. But he always, you know, he always said, don't fight you. And I remember you asked me off like early in that game and I said no. And I don't think you played very much for the rest of that game. I don't know if you even – I don't know if you even hit 4 minutes that game.
Be nice here.
No, I'm just saying. Hey, no, we've both been there. Trust me. This isn't a you thing. This is
the subtle chirp from Ryan Reaves.
No. This is a nice thing, baby. Not a you thing. But, yeah, so – Jesus. So I said no, and then, yeah, you cross-check Petro, and I was in my head, I was like, okay, well, I'm the new enforcer on the team. I got to go after you. But you're like, you're an absolute monster. So I had to, like, get some kind of upper hand. So I take you down. I know we're going to fight. We get up, and I just remember the same thing. I was trying to throw through my eyes, and you threw one, and I went to duck it and throw at you. And we both just completely missed.
Yeah.
And we go down, and I'm going to apologize for this right now. And I remember I hit you in the back of the head, and I don't like doing that. I've only done that twice in my career. But in my head, it was like, well, you cheap shotted Petro, and I didn't get a shot on you, so I got to get you with something. And it's so dirty. I hate guys that do that. That was one of two times. The only other guy I did that to was Jordan Tutu, but he had it coming.
Well, that's all right, man. I accept your apology. Well, listen, I don't want to take up any more of your time. I really appreciate it, man. You're a cool dude.
Absolutely. Anytime, man.
We're going to cross paths again down the road. But good luck the rest of the year.
Appreciate it.